Hi, my name is Jacob West. I'm the Director of Security Research at Fortify Software, recently acquired by Hewlett-Packard. And today I want to talk about the evolution of software security assurance, some of the origins of the practices that we take for granted today, and where I think some of those practices are going to go in the future. First, a little bit about myself. I got into the security field by working on a static analysis tool at UC Berkeley called MOPS. From there, I went on to work at Fortify for the last 7 years on building commercial-grade static analysis tools. And a few years ago, I was lucky enough to publish a book called Secure Programming with Static Analysis. I co-authored that with Brian Chess, one of our founders at Fortify. And that's all about how static analysis is applicable to the security problem and about the kinds of problems that static analysis is good at finding. So, to talk about the beginning of software security and software security assurance, we really have to go back to the beginning of the software industry. And the software industry was born in the late 1960s, early 1970s. And the main impetus, the main driver for the creation of an independent software industry was IBM decoupling software and services around the computer systems that they sold from the hardware itself. And the decoupling of these allowed consumers to start to think about security as a composite problem. They're buying hardware from one vendor, software systems and services and various solutions from other vendors, and then they begin to need to put all these together into a system that meets their business needs. And this created a security problem for the consumer because now not all systems were created equal. You weren't buying the X from IBM, you were buying a piece from here and a piece from there. So this created really a challenge that we call as a field software security. On one side, we have security professionals, people who used to configure the firewalls and perhaps try to attack systems that were deployed locally. And on the other side, you have people that are responsible for building software systems, developers, QA engineers, and so on. And software security is really bringing these two fields together, people who know about security, threats, attacks, countermeasures, and people who know about software systems, how to build them, how to test them. So today I'm going to talk about three key disciplines that contribute to software security assurance: threat modeling, code review, and penetration testing. And I'll talk a little bit about each of these, and then I'll talk about how we bring them all together from a compliance and risk management standpoint. So threat modeling is all about the kinds of problems that someone designing or building a system from the foundation up cares about. It's about understanding what things could go wrong with the system once it's eventually built, and designing the system and eventually implementing the system to avoid those eventual threats. The origins of threat modeling really come from a couple of key papers related to secure design principles. We had Saltzer and Schroeder publish a really seminal work on design principles in 1974. From it, we have principles like the principle of least privilege and others that carry on as kind of a foundation for computer security today. Maury Gasser published quite a bit on designing complete secure systems so that every aspect, the software, the hardware, and the eventual configuration all tie together to provide a secure solution. Threat modeling really encompasses a variety of other activities as well, things like architectural risk assessment, the development of abuse cases. But I'm going to talk about it generally as an all-encompassing field that's asking the question, what could go wrong with our system once we eventually build it and deploy it? In order to talk effectively about threat modeling, we have to understand what we mean by a threat. And different people have different definitions of this, but I like one that Matt Bishop published in his book, Computer Security. In the book, Matt says, a threat is a potential violation of security. Notice potential violation of security. Actions that could cause the violation to occur are called attacks. Those who execute such actions or cause them to be executed are called attackers. And if you notice the diagram at the bottom of the slide, it's really interesting to think about the idea that a threat is this collection of things: a potential vulnerability, so a potential weakness in a computer system that could be exploited; an attacker, someone who's interested in exploiting that system, has some motivation to compromise its security; and then the attack itself, some interaction with the software system that the attacker provides in order to elicit some desirable response, in order to exploit the potential vulnerability. The basic steps of a threat modeling activity or threat modeling process are as follows. First, the person or team performing the threat modeling needs to understand what the system is supposed to do. How is it designed? What are the major components? Where is certain functionality implemented? What are the underlying technologies and the implications that those may have on security? Really, the big picture of the system from a security and a technological standpoint. Next, the person or the team needs to enumerate scenarios in which the security of that system might fail. These are basically the hypotheticals, the what if there was an attacker and they mounted a certain kind of attack and the system was vulnerable in a certain way. These aren't necessarily vulnerabilities that we know to be true, know to be present, but instead they are hypotheticals, they're things that could go wrong. Once we've enumerated this list, and we may include things that are very, very likely to occur, we may include things that are very, very far-fetched, very unlikely to occur. But once we create this list and we try to make it as complete as possible, the next step is to go through and prioritize the elements on the list, decide which threats, which potential failures are most important, introduce the most risk to the business. Once we've prioritized them, then we can begin from most important to least important to associate remediation or responses with those threats, with those potential security failures. And what we write down may be that we've changed the design of the system to mitigate this threat, and therefore we don't think it will be real anymore. Or it may be that we write down a justification why the threat is maybe not serious enough that we need to respond to it. We think the maximum impact would be so low that this isn't something we have to respond to. Or it may be a pointer forward into the development cycle or into a future development cycle saying, okay, for this release, this is acceptable, but in the future, we think this risk would be too great and that we need to address it in the next major release or the next patch. One of, I think, the most valuable aspects of threat modeling is the way it can inform other activities in the development lifecycle. In particular, the two that I'm talking about today, code review and penetration testing, can benefit a great deal from threat modeling. In the case of code review, during your threat modeling activity, you can identify the attack surface for the application, and you can identify code that may be at risk or is the target of one of the threats that you've enumerated. Once you've done this, then you can prioritize your code review activities and prioritize the static analysis results that you just decide to review and remediate based on that knowledge of the threat model for the application. From a penetration testing standpoint, because penetration testing is all about emulating what a hacker would do, what an attacker would do to the system, the threat model is really a scorecard to measure the effectiveness of your penetration test. It says, have I exercised attacks in my penetration test that enumerate all the possible threats I think the system might experience once it's deployed? And if you've got shortcomings there, then you can expand your repertoire of penetration testing attacks, inform that repertoire, or expand it using the threat model that you've already developed. So now my favorite, probably code review. As I said, I got into software security from a code review static analysis standpoint. The origins of what we do in code review today really come from formal methods and verification processes. One of the most seminal works in this area was a document called the Orange Book Standard, also known as the Trusted Computer System Evaluation Criteria, published by the DoD in 1983 and has been revised multiple times since then. The idea is you can inspect software at its source code level without executing the software, without having to put it in all the various states that you want to test. And the benefit of this is that you get complete and consistent coverage across the entire code base. It also gives you the root cause of the problem. So as opposed to pointing out a URL or parameter that might be vulnerable, using code review, you can point a developer to the line of code where the vulnerability actually exists and where they need to implement a solution. Early static analysis tools got a bad reputation when it came to helping developers with code review. Because in the early days, we're talking around 2000, 2001, tools like RATS, It's4, Flaw Finder. In the early days, these weren't really bug finding tools. They were, in a way, glorified grep. They could collect a long list of functions that might lead to security vulnerabilities. And then they could analyze an entire program for every instance of those functions or methods that might lead to a vulnerability. The problem is it was unable to tell which ones were really exploitable and which ones weren't. And because of that, it created a lot of false positives and a lot of work for developers. One of the biggest differences in modern static analysis tools, And one of the biggest benefits that static analysis can bring to a security process today is the ability to prioritize those exploitable vulnerabilities from the lower priority, less exploitable vulnerabilities. To give you an idea of how a static analysis tool works, what the architecture is, up front we have a phase called translation. And in translation, we parse a bunch of source code and build a model of the application. And then on that model, we perform our subsequent types of analysis. Most modern static analysis tools implement more than one kind of analysis because different kinds of analysis are suited at finding different kinds of vulnerabilities. In particular, things like data flow analysis or taint propagation are very good at finding exploitable vulnerabilities and differentiating those from ones that might only be a bad practice or kind of bad code hygiene. Eventually, once the analysis is complete, and as an input to that, you'll notice in the diagram there's a set of rules or a knowledge base of security principles, security problems that we want to look for. Once we've finished our analysis, we present findings to the user. And I think this is one of the most important stages in the review process because this is where the human gets to decide what's important to our business, what's a real vulnerability, what isn't, which ones do we need to prioritize for remediation. And this is where the security of the software actually gets improved. So why is static analysis good for security? It's very fast compared to manual code review. Anyone who's reviewed code by hand understands that they can probably get through a few hundred, maybe 400 or 500 lines of code before they're done for the day, exhausted, their eyes have glazed over. Static analysis, on the other hand, is able to hypothesize an infinite number of states that the software might be in and completely and consistently check those for security vulnerabilities every time the analysis is performed. In addition, it's fast compared to runtime testing techniques. Because of the ability to hypothesize or simulate states that the software might be in, it's able to radically reduce the time it takes the tester to consider all of those possible states. For developers and other people who aren't security experts, aren't part of the security team, one of the most important things that static analysis can provide is bringing security knowledge along with it. So as opposed to just pointing out potential problems, can also bring a description of those problems and advice on how to correct them along with it and provide those in a contextual way to the developer when he or she needs them. As I mentioned, and as I'll continue to mention, the different techniques I talk about today feed into each other really nicely, and static analysis is no exception. In particular, static analysis can give a white box perspective to penetration testing activities. Otherwise, those have a black box perspective. They look at the application from the outside. But with the benefit of static analysis, they can see the implementation, the configuration files, and so on, and gain insight into what the application is actually doing before they attack it. So let's talk about penetration testing. The origins here are kind of twofold. There's one camp that came from the Department of Defense and some funding from IBM back in those early software days called Tiger Teams. And Tiger Teams were all about looking at a deployed system, a collection of hardware and software, and deciding, is it safe? Is it good? They tried to beat on it as hard as they could to find security vulnerabilities, but it was within the context of one organization, usually internally focused. In 1993, Dan Farmer wrote a paper, released a tool called Satan, and was subsequently fired for the combination of those two, that began to say, okay, we shouldn't just beat on our own systems when they're complete. We should think about the components that go into those systems, the individual software applications, both that we develop internally or that we acquire as off-the-shelf software, and execute a repertoire of attacks that we know those systems will face when they're actually deployed in the wild. And Satan was the first such automated penetration testing tool, a tool that collected these attacks that systems would face in the wild and mounted them against internal systems or systems that an organization was trying to determine the security of. There are a lot of automated tools today in this space. Penetration testing has been heavily automated. Some of those do a better job than others, but all of them are quite effective at finding certain classes of vulnerabilities, and we'll talk more about those in a moment. So a typical penetration test has three primary phases, and these are often repeated again and again. First, the penetration tester, whether it's a human or a tool, will crawl the application, try to identify all the pages, all the URLs, all the parameters that the application exposes to the user via the web. Then, for each one of those pages, the tool or the human tester executes a number of attacks, And these attacks are based on attacks that we've seen in the wild. They're based on attacks that we see being effective against certain kinds of vulnerable coding constructs that we've identified from the static analysis perspective, for example. But whatever they are, the collection of attacks get mounted. And then the third phase is looking for responses from those attacks, looking for which ones were effective, which ones might have triggered an exception to be raised or some sensitive information to be leaked out of the site. Whichever attacks are effective, those are the ones that lead us to report a vulnerability, lead us to report a weakness or a flaw in the system. One of the big challenges of penetration testing is that it's hard for it to do a comprehensive job. It's hard for it to test every page for every kind of vulnerability and ensure that it's followed every path through the code behind that application. The reality is, even with this challenge in coverage, penetration testing is highly effective at finding vulnerabilities in web applications today. A company called White Hat Security does a penetration testing service, and they've released statistics that you see on the slide now related to the likelihood that a given site, a given web application, will contain at least one instance of a certain class of vulnerability. And you can see that with 66% effectiveness, they're able to find cross-site scripting in web applications. The two-thirds of web applications that they've looked at are vulnerable to cross-site scripting and are vulnerable in a way that penetration testing can find, even with the limitations that we discussed. I think penetration testing of the three fields areas that I've talked about today can benefit the most from combination with the other techniques. And in particular, static analysis and penetration testing have a really nice relationship because of the black box, white box aspect. Research that I've worked on in the last few years falls under a title I like to call correlation. And the idea here is we want to perform our penetration test, perform our static analysis, and then bring the results together in some very meaningful way. As an example, imagine we found a dynamic SQL injection vulnerability with our penetration test. And with an existing static analysis, we've already found that there's a related SQL injection vulnerability that we found with static analysis, and another log forging vulnerability that we haven't found with our penetration test. Because we can relate these, we can correlate the static and dynamic results, we can not only reprioritize the static SQL injection vulnerability and give the developers root cause remediation details about the line of code they need to fix, as opposed to just the URL that the pen test would have told them about. We can also say that the second static analysis result, the log forging issue, should be reprioritized at a higher level as well, because it receives input from the same vulnerable parameter that the penetration test successfully used to exploit the SQL injection vulnerability. So in this case, we're able to not only relate the same vulnerability found using static and dynamic analysis, static and penetration testing, we're also able to relate the dynamic vulnerability with other similar static analysis vulnerabilities. And this is where the real power of correlation comes in. So we've talked about these three disciplines of software security assurance, threat modeling, code review, and penetration testing. And we've seen that each of these has come from a very different set of origins, one from secure design principles, one from verification and formal methods, and one from trying to break or attack running systems from the Tiger team and early penetration testing days. These three disciplines, to be most effective moving forward, are going to begin to converge more and more. And they're going to converge under one of a couple of possible umbrellas. Most people who perform software security assurance do it for one of two reasons. Either they're motivated by a desire to manage their risk. This is really an internally facing motivation. Our business faces certain risks. We might lose revenue or customers. We need to take security activities to avoid those risks that we think impact our business. This is a very common motivation. The second motivation is a compliance or standardization motivation. I need to comply with someone else's rules about the systems that I'm building or the kind of software that I operate. PCI DSS is an example of an external compliance standard that the big credit card companies have put down on software vendors that want to process credit card transactions. Interestingly, risk management is a bad motivation for software security. For the most part, humans are bad at managing risks. We're not good at identifying all the risks that might be out there, and we tend to focus on our own risks rather than risks that affect all of society or the collective. For this reason, we think compliance will be a more important driver for software security activities and will be more valuable to mature organizations trying to partake in software security activities than a pure risk management approach. The question that inevitably is raised here, however, is what do we need to comply with? Just as we can't make restaurants deliver safe food by testing every burrito that's sold in the mission, we can't ask software organizations to comply at the line of code level or with every piece of software that they write, because verifying and holding them to those standards is simply too great a task. In an attempt to provide a more useful bar, something that organizations really could strive to comply and measure themselves against, a group of researchers led by Gary McGraw and Brian Chess has embarked on a project called the Building Security and Maturity Model. And another group led by OWASP with Praveer Chandra has started a project called the Software Assurance Maturity Model, or OpenSAM. Both of these projects set out to measure, rather than the artifacts that software organizations build, they set out to measure the process that they use to build those artifacts. So how do they instill security in their software development lifecycle? How do they bring these different activities like threat modeling, code review, and penetration testing to bear on those systems? Based on these projects and Fortify's experience with our customer base, we find that organizations move through a few levels of maturity when it comes to a software security assurance program, and in particular leveraging these key disciplines that I've talked about today. In the beginning, we find that the security team works alone. They leverage some technology, maybe it's static analysis, maybe it's penetration testing. Usually it's one of those two. Threat modeling tends to come in more mature organizations. But they leverage some technology to start to point out security problems. They look at a small set of programs, usually the most critical to the business, and they find very specific vulnerabilities that provide after-the-fact value to the business. They find a problem, they fix it in the next release, security has gotten better, but the progress is very incremental and very slow. At the next phase, we find security begins to engage the development organization. And here we get the real acceleration of scale, where we have a large development organization able to, even if they only do a little bit of security, they're able to do it in a lot of places and affect a lot of systems. So we see the bar for security raised across a larger number of applications and across the organization. And then finally, in the last phase, we see development really taking ownership of security. Security is now a requirement of the systems, the software that they build, the same as performance, reliability, and functionality always have been. In this case, we find the bar set quite high for security across all software that the organization develops. Security is able to step back and take a more forward-looking, the role of maybe a general in a war, looking at how are we going to allocate resources? What technologies do we need to be thinking about next year or 3 to 5 years down the road? What can we do to really enable the development team to get security right every time they're faced with one of those critical decisions? In the end, what Fortify and Hewlett-Packard have found is critical to getting software security right is a combination of people, process, and of course, technology. I come from a tools perspective, so the technology is real exciting to me. But I found that the people and process side of this, how we make it all work, who we get buy-in from, how we train and roll out technology to our people, is even more important to making an effective software security organization than the technology that underpins that. I think looking forward, one of the most exciting areas in software security assurance is going to be the convergence of threat modeling, penetration testing, code review together to provide more meaningful results, better prioritization, and overall more secure software. With that, thank you very much. I hope some of you get to hear the full version of this talk when I deliver it, and I look forward to seeing you at another RSA.